system geared to encouraging creativity that leads to innovation and strong culture of entrepreneurship. And I think that's something we need to reflect on across the region. I think it's a very important point, and it's something that I don't think that we are fully understanding how it limits our ability to generate new areas of growth. Are there support systems for young entrepreneurs? Innovation must be encouraged if economic diversification is to take place. And I think that we need to find and ask ourselves, are we supporting, and governments and as well as other businesses as well, supporting young entrepreneurs? Because I think this is an important aspect of how we address our small size and the vulnerability that presents to us and diversify our economies. I wanted to also reflect on one point that was made as well about the business environment. We were told we had 5 minutes to do this presentation. There's a long list of things, and one of the members of the audience mentioned the fact that they had difficulties in going through and setting up or doing some transaction related to business activity in terms of the incentives, I believe. And I think this is a very important point. I think that there's a lot of inefficiencies in the way in which we do business. And it's not just government, but also in the private sector. But I think it's more important for government to create, and the role of government is very important, in creating an enabling environment for business. And if we're failing to do that, governments across the region are failing to do that, then what you're doing is you're making it more challenging for business to operate, you're adding to the cost of doing business, you're making it more difficult for us to compete globally and regionally and globally. So I think we need to look much more closely at the interface between the public sector and the private sector. And there's a long list of changes that are required if we are to support and create that enabling environment for the private sector. There was the whole question of greed and corruption. I can't dispute that. That is clearly a factor in the sort of developments that we're seeing globally and why we are where we are right now. I wanted to make a point about fiscal consolidation and growth, and I think this was a point that Michael made as well. The study, the IMF presentation, David talked about the need for fiscal effort. I think this is very important. Michael mentioned the whole need to balance. And I think the balancing is very important because we have a reality here in this region where perhaps of our own making, the private sector is not as dynamic as we would like them to be. It might be for the same reasons that are mentioned before in terms of the way in which the types of obstacles they face in trying to do business. But the private sector essentially has not been able to lead and push growth. Now, if you have a situation in which you're asking for this level of fiscal effort and adjustment, then you have to be mindful of the fact that you're not going to have the commensurate effort on the part of the private sector to generate growth. And so then you might find yourself in a situation where you're contributing to a further slowing of the recovery within this region. So I think there has to be a balance. Government perhaps can make some gains in terms of looking at its operation and how it's operating, yes, perhaps being more efficient in terms of its expenditure, and I agree, this is where the whole issue of equity comes in, and you mentioned, David, the whole notion of us, well, not notion, but the fact that we are in a situation where our per capita GDP has doubled and we have not looked at our welfare system, and perhaps that's something we need to really consider. I think better targeting is not to suggest that we should not provide and help those who are most in need. Coming from development bank, I cannot ignore that. But I would suggest that perhaps we need a better target. I don't see that there's anyone in here who should be getting health care necessarily free. I don't think we are at the point where we can say that we need to have free health care for all, or free, dare I say it, education for all. But I think we need to look at targeting these things. I think the time has come when we cannot ignore it anymore. I think if we target, the benefit of targeting is that by targeting, you are giving more to those who are more in need. If you take the resources and spread it across everyone, then essentially you are spreading those resources fairly thin, as opposed to concentrating those resources on those who are more in need, and you then find that you have a better way of dealing with those who are vulnerable in your society than when you have this blanket system of free education and free health for all concerned.
Thank you. Justin?
Yes, I guess I'm still in the middle. I guess I hate to bring a high-level conference like this down to this level, but as I was thinking about the issues, my mind just kept going back to the crop over finals and the winner of the competition. I should most remember Popsicle with his song where he said, no matter how long this recession lasts, he's not going to sell. And as I've listened, I've started thinking maybe that donkey is in trouble and he might have to sell after all. And how do we protect him? It should really be our concern. As I said earlier, I mean, the environment going forward is definitely going to be a very challenging one. And there's really no way out of that. There's no easy solution to managing a fiscal consolidation at the same time while you are trying to generate growth. I don't think there has been and ever will be an easy way out of that. But I think Denny sort of touched on what I would have wanted to say to some extent, where if we look on the expenditure side, and John asked on that expenditure side, whether or not we really want to look at the whole issue of targeting. I'm part of a commission in the OECS where we are looking at public expenditure reform in the OECS, and that issue has come up. And in the public discussions, I think in Antigua, one guy put it starkly, should the millionaire's son and the fisherman's son both get free university education? I mean, is that a system that you want to have? So, I mean, if we provide free education, a guy becomes a high-powered accountant and he gets wealthy, should the state then still fund university education for his children? In a sense, having empowered that person, can those resources then be diverted to someone else? I guess, and the broad issue there is targeting or means testing, and have we actually gotten to the point within our economies where we have to look at that issue of means testing so that we get the largest bang for our buck, that the persons who really need are the ones who are actually benefiting. As I said earlier, that trade-off between equity and efficiency, and again, my experience in the last few years, I have found, and I don't know if it's true across the region, in that almost every time we've had to make a choice or make a decision, I mean, equity almost always wins. I've always been haunted by a speech I experienced at Manchester in my macroeconomic policy course there. We had a speech from the then president of Tanzania, and he said that when he became president, they had set out with the goal of creating an equal society. And he said, you know, we have been incredibly successful. Most of our people are now just about equally poor. You know, and that has always stuck with me. And in a sense, if equity keeps winning, as important as that is, that can have consequences for the size of the economic pie. And I think that's something we really need to think about as a culture. I still wanted to hear David's thoughts on that international business side. I think that's an important sector for us. Finance is now a bad word, but it seems to me, certainly within our chunk of the region, financial services would seem to me to be an integral part of any growth strategy going forward. We have invested primarily in our human resources. It has a small environmental footprint. It seems to me that's a sector that has to play a critical role. And I think that regulatory tax that hangs over the sector right now has really become a burden and is something that needs to be addressed. Thank you.
Michael.
Thank you very much, Governor. While we are patient and confident, I want to suggest that there are three sort of general areas where I would suggest that public and private sector focus attention, dollars, and resources. The first has to do with what I call education for entrepreneurship. I think this is a very vital area, and that if I had a magic wand, I would want to be very specific in terms of what universities and public sector schools do in terms of educating people for entrepreneurship. That's a whole area which I think is very important, and I think it's an area that requires focus, because I think you can educate people for entrepreneurship. The second is what I call institutional strengthening. We see, you know, varying degrees of efficiency and efficacy in terms of our institutions around the region, in terms of very simple things as the collection of income tax, the collection of VAT, the way hospitals administered. I think there's a lot of work to be done in institutional strengthening, both in the financial and in the provision of general services. But the third area where I would like to perhaps spend a little bit more time is in the area of foreign direct investment, because I believe that if you look at the economic history of this region over the last 30 years or so, where there have been major interventions in terms of growth in economic activity, you know, almost in most cases, or in several cases, and I would say perhaps in the majority of cases, the hand of the foreign direct investor has been present. And I would ask colleagues to just reflect a little bit about one very, in my view, very good experience that this region has had in terms of growing the economic base. And I refer to the Point Lisa's development in Trinidad and Tobago. When I was a young man entering business, it was flat land, basically cane land. If you go there today, there's a huge enterprise in terms of all the monetization of gas and basically the monetization of gas. And I think that that is the approach that we have to take region-wide. We have to say to ourselves today, what are the new industries? What are the new areas?